And hello and greetings to all of you joining us from all over the world. Welcome today. This is the 2022 Accredited Speakers Program. The Toastmasters International Accredited Speakers Program is designed for members who combine subject mastery with professional speaking skills, and they have reached a level of proficiency that enables them to be paid professional speakers. I see the accredited speaker smiling at that one. Since 1981, the Accredited Speakers Program has recognized 89 individual Toastmasters. With this prestigious designation, many of them are here with us today. To recognize those who have achieved this designation, we have provided a link to a full list of these accredited speakers. Please visit the accredited speaker page on the Toastmaster website to learn more. The journey to become an accredited speaker takes years of planning and training. In January, the application process for level one opens to all eligible members. Candidates submit an application and a video recording of presentations performed in front of a live audience. Applications and recordings are evaluated by a panel of experienced judges and are scored using an official judge's guide and a ballot. Those who meet the judging criteria advance to level two, which means they are invited to speak before you, an audience of Toastmasters members, guests, future Toastmasters, and judges on a topic they would normally give to their clients, a non-Toastmaster audience. This year, I am pleased to share that we have one accredited speaker candidate, Kevin Snyder from North Carolina, United States. Today's presentation will be evaluated by a panel of anonymous judges and scored on content, delivery, and language. If today's candidate passes the level two presentation, he will receive the prestigious accredited speaker designation. Copying, streaming, or reproducing this program, strictly prohibited. I'm looking at you online. The program will be available to view on demand in the online convention platform. It is my pleasure to introduce Kevin Snyder, distinguished Toastmaster. Dr. Kevin Snyder, distinguished Toastmaster, is a recovering motivational speaker who has presented keynotes and leadership trainings worldwide. He's spoken to over 1 million people through 1,500 audiences in all 50 states and numerous countries. Kevin credits Toastmasters for a significant portion of his speaking achievements. He's served in every club officer role and currently is a founding charter member for and president of Speaking Professionally Toastmasters. We have some fans here. He has also published several books, two of them achieving Amazon bestseller status and number one new release. Prior to professional speaking, Kevin worked in student affairs at several universities. He earned a doctorate degree in educational leadership. He's presented several TEDx talks and is a certified skydiver, scuba diver, and a sailboat captain. later this fall, he is going to be attempting a Guinness World Record for the longest speech in history. Some of you look concerned. No, no, don't worry. It's not this speech he's presenting today. Kevin lives in North Carolina, United States, with his beautiful bride and family. His claim to fame is that he lived his childhood dream of winning big on the television game show The Price is Right. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Kevin Smith, Snyder, and Kevin Snyder. Kevin, come on down!
Come on, Music City! Twice as loud, come on! Hey, keep the heads up, here we go! Ladies, first verse.
Just a small town girl.
If everybody does it doesn't look weird.
Living in a lonely
here we go,
world.
Ladies! Ladies,
she took the midnight train going.
There we go, keep it going. Guys, my second verse, guys.
Just a city boy.
You can lower it, it's okay.
Born and raised in South Detroit.
I love this, this is awesome.
You took the midnight
we're gonna keep going. My online people, you got this too. All right, take a seat, everybody, take a seat. Give yourself a round of applause. Woo! Now turn to somebody next to you and say, hey, you sound pretty good. Give them a high five. Aww. Well, hey, how are we feeling today? Good? It is an honor to spend a little bit of time with you today. Let's give a shout out to that amazing, most random introduction of all time from Karen Lucas. Now, there was strategy behind that introduction. That is the same introduction, minus the Toastmasters comment, that is in every single one of my professional presentations. Any guesses why? How many of you have something in common with me that you identified before I even started speaking today? Raise your hand. All right, look around if somebody's got their hand not up. Check their pulse. See, I heard you back there. As speakers, it's very important because the cardinal rule with speaking is to know your audience. Would you agree? Right. So, in order to know your audience, you know who they are. I happen to be a Toastmasters, which is why I shared that with you. This is still a professional speech, though. Does that make sense? Right. So, what I strategically designed was so that you could have something in common with me, because if we have something in common, don't we better connect? And if we better connect as Toastmasters or as presenters, then we also are more relatable. And when we're more relatable as speakers, aren't we also more relevant? Yes or yes? I'm not giving you a choice, all right? So, for example, how many of you, let's just say, gosh, where are my Price is Right fans? All right, online, and my online, let's give our online people a round of applause. All right. And by the way, online people, I'm talking to you right now with that camera. Didn't this in-person audience sound pretty good? All right. Right. No, but many of you, whether it's The Price is Right or maybe a game show, right, that's something that likely many of us have in common. Now, I know some of you aren't going to raise your hand no matter how many times I ask a question. So how many of you would like $100? All right. I thought I had a bill. Did I give it to you, honey? Oh, here it is. Yeah. Oops, spoiler alert. Yeah, anybody want it? All right, who here wants $100? All right, something else we have in common. Oh, yeah. Oh my. All right. He did walk up here and take it though. I mean, however, I got another one for you. Don't tell him, that's a fake $100 bill. I just did that to make sure that we all know how to raise our hand. I know some of you don't like that, like my brother. It's okay. He'll never raise his hand in the speech. But also, how many of us are here today as Toastmasters? Yeah, we have a lot in common. But also, one more question for you as we get started today is how many of us understand the importance of telling a great story? right? Absolutely. And that's why we're here today. In fact, Karen, thank you so much for that introduction. She mentioned a word that's spot on. It doesn't matter what journey we're on as speakers, as Toastmasters, but we're all on a journey, aren't we? Don't stop believing. We're all on a journey. And for my journey to get here, it's been a couple years. In fact, it's been 20 years of speaking, but 3 years for this process. However, speaking has the opportunity to change lives. We're all on this journey. So when I found out that the theme of this event was we are all storytellers, I thought, that's the best theme possible. In fact, that is a brilliant theme. For any of you sitting here or online, we're involved on the planning committee to set the theme for this conference. Let's give them a round of applause. There could not be a better theme for what we're dealing with right now to help us connect and inspire people through story. So something interesting happened just recently as I was preparing these remarks for you. And I trust that. When something unique happens as I'm preparing for a client, whether I'm paid or not, I trust that. I trust that experience. Well, what happened was my brother and I were at the same conference. My brother is involved with a nonprofit organization helping organizations and people in Ukraine finding homes here in America. Well, he and I were at the same conference. He was there as a volunteer. The difference was I was getting paid. And it was their annual meeting. Now, something you need about my brother, he and I have completely different personalities, okay? Different personalities. He's taller, more hair, better looking, but I'm still mom's favorite, all right? No. But my brother gave me the biggest compliment of all. After he had to wait in line to chat with me, which I thought was hashtag awesome, he said, I can't believe you get paid for this. That was a compliment coming from my brother. But he continued. He said, all you did was get up and share a bunch of stories that made sense, that connected, and that inspired people. I watched it. He goes, you even inspired me. Didn't expect that. And so, my friends, if you're taking notes online, if you're taking notes, please put this in the chat as well. The greatest speakers are the greatest what?
Storyteller.
Let's say that again like we mean it. The greatest speakers are also the greatest storytellers. Yes. But also the greatest professional speakers are also the greatest problem solvers. Let me say that one more time. Write that down in the chat. Write that down if you're taking notes. The greatest professional speakers are the greatest problem solvers. Does that make sense? Because a story has to have a point. That point has to help an audience solve a problem. And that problem, also, what we're sharing, has to inspire the audience to want to do something with that information. I call that a call to action. So, if a story that we're sharing in a presentation, or a series of stories in a presentation, can inspire people with a point, helping them with their problem that we likely don't even know what they're dealing with, but also equip them with action steps that they can take. My friends, fellow Toastmasters, we're all, that's one thing we all have in common. That is art. Storytelling, when done properly, incorporating those fundamentals, is art, in my opinion. The audience happens to be the canvas. Think about that. Would you agree with that? So we are artists. And we have to curate every single speech. And trust me, we all know this, how much time we might go into a 5 to 7 minute speech. To our international speech contest folks, congratulations. Let's give them a round of applause, all of them. I know when I competed, last time I competed, I went through 37 scripts. I hired 2 world champions to help me with that. I spent a lot of money, spent a lot of time, and I didn't even win. But was it worth it? It helped me, led me to what I'm doing with you today. So, I've not even gotten to my 3 principles yet that I'm sharing with you. Today, I'm going to share 3 principles, 3 insights, 3 fundamentals that are universal, that are timeless, and can help you in any arena of life if they are applied. Are you ready? Because I want to also not just help you become and think about how to become a better storyteller today. I also want to help inspire you and hopefully equip you with some ideas on how to help you also be respectfully a better human. Because our organizations can't grow unless we do first. And there are a lot of organizations I talk to who get that opposite. They want to grow, but they're not investing in their people. And right now, there are a lot of organizations that still haven't thought differently. They're still pivoting rather than shifting. Pivoting, you're going around in circles. It's temporary for protection. It's a basketball term. You got to take your foot up. You got to pass. You got to shoot in order to move forward. Does that make sense? So if you feel like you're an organization or maybe even a club that's still pivoting, well, one of the first things we need today is say, what do we need to do to actually shift? Or maybe you're in a relationship that way. There's opportunity. I feel today that I can help you with at least some insights to help you think differently about that. Are we ready? Online folks, are we ready? Okay, good. All right. I have a softball question for you. I've got three principles. We're going to get through them in about 8 minutes because that's all the time left. And if I speak any longer than that, I will have to charge you. Okay? So how many of you, by show of hands, could be physically somewhere else right now? Raise your hand. Okay. Freeze. Look around. All right? Online people, I don't know if you can see the people in person, but freeze again. If somebody you're sitting next to does not have their hand up, check their pulse. Right? Couldn't we all be somewhere different right now? And the answer is absolutely. But we made a choice to do what? We made a choice to show up. And that is something we can never underestimate, is the power of showing up. So turn to somebody to your left or right or somewhere. You don't have to touch them. Maybe give them an air five. Post it in the chat too. Say, don't stop showing up. And I learned the importance of showing up when I went to college. I only applied to one college because it's the only college I thought I could get into. I remember making an 870 on the SAT, which wasn't enough to even get in that school. I had mediocre grades, a lot of self-doubt. So I knew I had to show up for class. Well, my roommate had a near perfect score on the SAT, near perfect grades in high school. He made a choice not to show up for class. He flunked out the first semester. I made a 4.0. No. Thank you, but all right, yeah, all right. But it had nothing to do with my intellect. It had everything to do with my work ethic. Not necessarily about my IQ, more so about my I will. And I'll never forget going to a chemistry class, and I did not do well in chemistry. So I have no clue why I double minored in it. But I remember Dr. Boyd had an exam review session. And because I wasn't the smartest kid, or at least that's what I told myself, I went to it because I knew I needed it. Class of 300 students, four of us showed up. That was the test. Dr. Boyd said, because you showed up today, this is a lesson in life. Congratulations. If any of you are teachers, use that. Do it. I didn't know Dr. Boyd was a motivational speaker. But let's be real for just a moment. Can it be tough to show up sometimes? Yeah. It can be real tough. Some of us might be physically present today, but mentally, yeah, we got something going on. Or for those of you watching, I mean, all of us, every single one of us, something else we have in common is there's something in our life we might like to see different or we might like to see changed. Now, I've got my beautiful wife here, and that's perfect. Like, my family, I'm just so honored. But there are things even in my life that I like to see a little different, right? So I can't ever not stop showing up. I've got to keep showing up in the right ways. When I was 12, I was diagnosed with depression. And I was also diagnosed with an eating disorder called anorexia. And the doctors didn't know what to do with me in the 80s. I was like the first boy that they had ever met that had those conditions. And that's a whole nother program. And what got me through it was three things. Number one, the unconditional love for my mom and my dad. Wouldn't be here today. I would not be alive. Number two, it was counseling. And then number three was musical therapy. I played piano, I wrote music, I sang, and music was more a distraction for my own thoughts than anything. And I'll never forget a question that my counselor asked me after a full year of silent counseling sessions where I literally stared at the floor three times a week for 45 minutes for an hour. It's a very dark time for me. And she says, Kevin, what would you do driving home today if you heard a song on the radio that you didn't like? What would you do? Yeah, back in the 80s, you changed the station. Now you swipe left, up, down. But, see, I didn't realize, and this is what she said. Carol said to me, Kevin, just because you have a thought you don't like, it doesn't mean you have to keep listening to it. I didn't realize I had that power. I mean, what 13-year-old would? What adult might? See, today I want to remind you, my fundamentals are pretty simple. I want to remind you of what you already know. It's not what we know, it's what we apply. So guess what song came on the radio when my mom and I got in the car that day? Don't Stop Believing. This song changed my life. It's my phone ring. My wife will admit that. It's my wake-up call. This is in every single presentation. How many of us have to be self-motivated to do what we do? All of us. Motivation is the number one determinant of our success. Never underestimate not just the power of showing up, but also the power of believing. That's when my journey really began. Because I had contemplated suicide many times. And I want to share something with you that I just discovered. This is not the first time I've presented it for an audience, but this is the first time I've ever delivered it with an audience that I believe can appreciate it. And it's called a reverse poem. I don't know if you've ever heard of a reverse poem, but I took a poem that when I journaled when I was sick, I took a poem and I just found this as I was cleaning some boxes. And I thought, wow, I can't imagine how I used to think that way. And so what I did in preparation for this speech, I wanted to reverse it to show you the power of perspective, the power of the narrative, power of thinking different. Is it okay if I share it with you? Okay. So what I need you to do to fully appreciate this, I want you to look at the words on the screen, and I want you to follow along. I'm going to be speaking on top. So to our online friends, if we can make sure that they're seeing only the screen. The music you're going to hear is also music I wrote at this same time, many years ago. So I'm very excited to share this with the Toastmasters family for the first time. Here we go. Can you play the song? So please look at the words. My thinking can never be changed. So stop trying to tell me things can be different and hope always prevails. Because at the end of the day, it's too much of a negative and divisive world. So I'm not gonna lie to you or myself by saying there's hope for a better future. I believe I'm incapable of making a real difference. And nothing you say will persuade me that I've made too many mistakes in the past. I just don't believe the nonsense that my past struggles have developed strength. Because when I look in the mirror, can my thinking really be any different? Can my thinking really be any different? Because when I look in the mirror, my past struggles have developed strength. And I just don't believe the nonsense that I have made too many mistakes in the past. And nothing you say will persuade me that I am incapable of making a real difference. Because I believe there is hope for a better future. So I'm not gonna lie to you or myself by saying it's too much of a negative and divisive world. Because at the end of the day, things can be different, and hope always prevails. So stop trying to tell me my thinking can never be changed. Today, I choose to think differently. Thank you. I was hoping you'd like it. I'm just the messenger with a message. If we're looking for problems in an organization, we will find them. If we're looking for problems in a speech, we will find them. If we're looking for problems in a relationship, we will find them. It is time that we think differently. So turn to your neighbor one more time and say, hey, don't stop thinking different. Now, my final principle for you today, and I'm so honored by your time, is this. When I went back to my counselor, that final session, or one of the final sessions that we had, she goes, Kevin, I want you to think of something. What's something you can look forward to every day? Well, my mom and I got home that day, and we had lunch, and we're sitting there watching The Price is Right. Now, where are my Price is Right fans again? All right. Now, I didn't realize this show would become an obsession, okay? And long story short, my mom and I would be going to the grocery store together. She'd be shopping for groceries. What do you think I was doing? I'm price checking. Now, some of you maybe you don't have Prices Right in your country, but you might have a similar game show. For example, in Germany, it's called Der Preis ist heiß. All right. I believe in Spain or Argentina, it's El Precio Cuarto. In the UK, Australia, or Canada, in the United States, it's The Price is Right. So a teenager should not know the price of prune juice or Metamucil, right? That comes a little bit later. I go to college, I actually write a paper on The Price is Right, the psychology of winning of The Price is Right. And the teacher, Dr. LaVon Adams, gives me my paper back a week later with a grade of C, me after class. I go to Dr. Adams, I had my bags packed, remember? Go to Dr. Adams, she holds a copy of my paper in front of my face, says, Kevin, in all my years of teaching, this is the best paper I've ever read. But you have a problem. You're obsessed with this show. That obsession took a new level after that. When Dr. Adams told me I was really good at writing, what do you think I started to believe? That I was really good at. Never underestimate the power of our words. The belief that one person can have in us and that we can have in others. Wow. I arranged my entire class schedule around the show. And I made a vision that I would be shaking hands with Bob Barker one day. So I met a guy at a leadership conference. I didn't want to go, but I showed up. And I met this guy named Chris. And Chris and I, we had an immediate connection. At a workshop that we did, the icebreaker was to stand on the chair that was sitting there, stand on the chair, to the group that you don't know, share something unique about yourself that nobody else would know. So Chris jumps on his chair. Hey guys, my name's Chris. I'm from the University of California at San Diego. And well, most people wouldn't know that I was just on The Price is Right and I won a gazebo. Oh my God. Shut the front door. Are you kidding me? And for the next 3 days of this leadership conference, all I could talk to Chris about was how to get on the show. And he told me. So for those of you who want to know how to get on The Price is Right, just reach out to me. You can send me an email. I'm pretty easy to find. Just make sure you spell my last name right. Otherwise, it goes to some guy in Georgia who hates me. Okay, now. So I order tickets for the show. I follow him. Catch this. Here is the ticket from 1998. Oh, yeah. I'm keeping that. All right. I look at the date. And the date is the same date as my college graduation. Now, something you need to know about me, I went to college at the University of North Carolina at Wilmington. And if we can see the slide here, then that you see a map of the United States. Can we show this slide, please? I'm clicking it. There we go. All right, so 3,000 miles. I had to make a choice. Go to The Price is Right or go to my college graduation, what would you do? Online audience, what would you do? Price is Right or graduation? At the thrill of my parents, I skipped my college graduation to drive 3,000 miles across the country. I show up the morning of the taping. The parking lot is empty. The gate is locked with this sign. I then get escorted by security off property. They tell me that Bob Barker was sick. And as I drive back home, I gave up on the dream. That negative thoughts, those thoughts came back like a flood. It turned into inner toxic head trash. I gave up on the dream. My mom is waiting for me in the driveway. She gives me a hug and she says, "Don't stop believing." Didn't know my mom was a motivational speaker too. I go upstairs, order tickets, wait 2 months. Who likes to wait? Nobody. Chris picks me up from the airport. Then we go back to the parking lot. It's empty because we're first in line. 10 a.m. We wait in line all night long. 10 a.m. the next day, the music starts playing. I got a quick video, edited, very short video, or I can just tell you what happened. What would you prefer? All right, here we go.
Here it comes from the Bob Barker Studio at CBS in Hollywood. Television's most exciting hour of fantastic prizes. The fabulous 60-minute Price is Right. Kevin Snyder, come on down. Actual retail price, $16.25. Ah, Kevin, thank you, thank you. Kevin, my man, listen to what Rod has to tell you.
Kevin, you have a chance to win $10,000 in cash.
$10,000 on the punch board. My boy, you are there with $5,000. $5,000. Oh, Kevin, you are $5,000 richer. You stop. He's going to quit right now. Well done. Spend your money wisely.
I'm going to leave that right here for you. And this was the front page of the paper when I got home that day. Snyder lives dream when the price is right. And it occurred to me that a 22-year-old boy battling depression lived a dream simply because he had one. And my friends, that's what I want to leave you with today, is to dream big. We are all capable of dreaming. We are capable of inspiring other people to dream big. The only question we have to ask ourselves is this: what's our price is right? What is your price is right? Right? We all have one. But are we willing to dream big? Two types of dreams: ones we have when we're sleeping, the others we have when we're awake. What would you prefer? So, turn to your partner, say this: don't stop believing. We are all capable of living a dream. We're all capable of inspiring other people to do the same thing with a story. As long as we believe, as long as we continue to think different, and as long as we don't stop showing up. I'm so honored for your time. Thank you so much, Toastmasters. Honored. Thank you.
Please give our judges 2 minutes of silence to complete their ballots.